Welcome, welcome once again. We continue our torrid pace here on July 4th. And it's absolutely necessary because we are entering into the belly of the beast of these times. And it is absolutely essential that those who can provide a sense of spiritual peace, a spiritual calm, spiritual stability, spiritual non-distraction, spiritual centeredness, that they be available to the world. Absolutely essential. And I pray the circumstances enable to free me up so I'm able to do more of this. And that the peace increase, the calmness increases quantumly, actually. We need quantum leaps now, okay? We need quantum leaps in spiritual advancement right now. Anything less, we're going to get steamrolled I don't want to be steamrolled. Does space ever get tired of what appears in space? Like there's a redwood tree. The redwood tree's been there 3,000 years or a long time. Bristlecone pine, maybe 4,000. Does the space, you know, where the bristlecone pine is appearing, does the space tired of the bristlecone pine tree being there and says, I wish there was something else there? Does space get tired? Does space have preferences? Does space have a preference? This bottle, does the space right here say, I don't really want that bottle in this space. Can you give something, put something else there? Is space preferential? Does it get tired? Does it get fatigued? Bored? Does space get bored? Say, gosh, this world has been here for billions of years. I'm so tired of this world. is that the way space is? I don't know. These are some questions. Keep in mind, say it's something that has no beginning and no ending. Isn't that speaking of perfect freedom and no process at all? If there's no process, how can we say something's had a beginning? If every moment is completely free, as Jesus tells us it is, and I certainly trust enough in Jesus to consider what he has to say at length and at depth, and I hope he appreciates that, because, you know, the fact is, no teacher, you cannot have remove all your doubts about any teacher or any teaching. It's impossible. Cannot. Only the inner experience, the Holy Spirit's vision of oneness, only that vision of oneness removes all doubts. And spent a lifetime trying to remove doubts about teachers and teachings. Can't do it. But when just a moment of the vision of oneness, just for momentarily seeing it, and all doubt was cast aside. Perfect love casteth out all fear. God, there was no doubt. There is no doubt that there was no doubt. So it's impossible, again, to remove your doubts about all doubts about any teacher. It's not possible. The best you can do is to have the trust and respect and trust them so much that you consider what they have to say, that you listen, that you follow their example. But, you know, the idea of worshiping the teacher and all this kind of stuff, you're trying to remove doubts about the teacher. It's an external appearance. They're using words. They're surrounded by everything. So why try to do it that way? That's not going to work. Vision of oneness removes all doubt, just like inherently so, because it's the light appearing to be the light. Light saying, hi, I'm here, I'm light, and I'm light. Light is light, here I am. Light is light, here I am. That's it. There's no doubt. There's no doubt. You say, light, that you certainly are here. You're everywhere. I'm aware of your everywhere presence. I'm aware of your everywhere presence, and there's no doubt about it. No doubt about it. That's why I say the only problem we have is the continuity problem. And the vision of oneness is the only value there is, because it solves a continuity problem. We don't have a teacher problem. I don't have a teacher problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a teaching problem. I have a continuity problem. The teacher problem has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value. The teaching problem has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. So, as long as we got that out of the way, it's a lot easier than to listen to what the teacher says, and you're not struggling like, Hey, I got a doubt about the teacher. Oh, that ruins everything. Or no. The continuity fear is going to raise these doubts for sure. And then tell you, hey, you got to solve those doubts first. What are you doing listening to them? You haven't solved your doubts. It's impossible to solve your doubts about any teacher. It cannot. Even Sri Anandamayi Ma, I have doubts about, you see. I have doubts about her teaching, doubts about her. Yeah, I cannot remove these doubts. And Brahman Maharshi, same Jesus Christ, everyone still have some doubts, still have doubts. And doubts about them, about their teaching. It's inherent in perception and adjustments, the realm of adjustments, which is based on the belief that light is not light. One moment. Okay. So as long as we're basing a premise that light is not light, how can we be sure of anything? How can we not doubt? Because at the bottom of our minds, we're doubting what everything we're seeing. You know, we just say, I kind of doubt that any of this is real. You know, and so anything appears to you in the world, you're going to doubt them too. So I'm not sure if this is bogus or true. Or nothing quite seems exactly true here, does it? But the light does such a great job of pretending to not be the light that we say, I'm almost sure, but I still have a little bit of doubt. Because the appearances seem to have convinced me, but I'm not still totally convinced. So in a context of not being totally convinced, which of course we cannot, since we are the light, so to speak, we're spirit, how can we be convinced that the light isn't the light? Despite all appearances of the contrary, how can we be convinced? We cannot be convinced. So that feeling of, I'm not being convinced, is going to be there. It's going to be there no matter who, what, no matter what. So, of course, we all want some teacher to remove our troubles for us, right? And we'll you know, try to surrender ourselves to the teacher. Like, I know you're going to do it. And eventually we say, you didn't quite do it. I still have a little bit of doubt. Well, the honest teacher will say, look, no, I'm not going to be able to remove. I'm not going to be able to give you certainty at all. No way. It's impossible. Don't even think about it. Forget it. Of course, the lazy student says, no. Well, I'll do anything you want. Just tell me you're going to remove uncertainty from me. No, cannot. And they'll insist upon it, of course. I say, no. I know you can do it. Here, let me do this for you. And a teacher cannot constantly be struggling with all those who insist, yes, you can do this for me, and I'm going to insist upon it. You know, holy cow. What if you walk down the street and everybody sang happy birthday to you? You know, wherever you went, happy birthday. You say, hey folks, it's not my birthday. You know, it's not my birthday. Are you going to say to every single person you meet, hey, it's not my birthday. Hey, it's not. Wasting time and effort, you know. So, if they want to sing happy birthday, let them sing happy birthday. But don't make the mistake of thinking that it is my birthday, okay? So, a teacher, people will come to the teacher, and they have all sorts of agendas for the teacher. They say, no, you can do this, teacher. I know you're going to do this for me, no question. I insist upon it. I'm here for that. Nonstop put the pressure, demands pressure. The teacher cannot spend all their time rejecting. The teacher just says, I'm going to keep teaching anyway. You know, if everyone is saying happy birthday to you, you couldn't stop them, you stop going out of the house, you stop circulating. No, I'm going to go out anyway. They're going to sing happy birthday, let them sing happy birthday. I can't waste my time saying no, you know, trying to negate, because then people think, oh, you're very negating. So you don't know the situation around a teacher. You don't know, there's so much different stuff going on. All that's important is the teacher is teaching that you're getting something there that from absolute stillness is speaking, conveying, inviting, reassuring. It's there. Let's bit by bit work through the continuity fear. Let's evaporate the continuity fear here. Let's just evaporate. Let's just work on evaporating. Don't worry the quibbles that come up. There's a quibble. Don't struggle with it. It's a given that you can't erase all doubts externally with any appearance. You cannot erase all doubts whatsoever. You cannot, well, if you did, the universe would, everything would disappear. The universe would disappear. You just, it basically, that's the leap. We're not making that kind of leap. We're taking the intermediate step. Vision of oneness is the intermediate step. So theoretically, you could, anything could erase all doubts and forever. It didn't have to be a teacher. Any moment could erase, you can erase all doubts immediately. That light is light, and it's always been light, and I don't even need any reassurance, boom. But we're not gonna do that. Nobody's gonna do that. No one is gonna do that. So we have to realize that, no, we're not going to remove the doubts. Doubts are okay. That's continuity fear. It's just kicking up. So you might be saying, whoa, go a little slower. Doubts are kicking up. Okay, go a little faster. So you go through that. You go through that with anyone. Sometimes there's doubts. Sometimes the doubts seem to ease up. But the doubts will always be there until you abide in the vision of oneness. So if something is, appearances that is in space are, there's no linkage between moments. Everything is appearing right now. It's free and clear of any other appearance at all. Even though we might want to have some consistency. So, but then how does anything have a beginning and an ending if there's no process? And if you can repeat the same experience endlessly, forever. How can you say it has a beginning and an ending? How can you look at it that way? Because you're always free to go back to it. Does freedom have a beginning? Perfect freedom actually have a beginning? Well, if there is a beginning, what was before it then? So in other words, the option is always there for everything. Everything is always an option. Everything is always an option. So does it really have a beginning? From the very quote-unquote, the very beginning, God, the Prime Creator, everything is always an option. So is there really a beginning to anything? Is the question. And it's never not an option. So to think of things in terms of beginnings and endings is very much off track. Because anything can remain forever if you want it to, appearance. And all options are equally available always. When you choose to experience this, something is at the beginning of that experience, or the experience has always been there. It's just you're shifting your attention to it. You can say, well, it was the beginning of my attention, but it's not. Your attention has always been there too, and your attention can always go back to it. So I'm just trying to loosen up the idea of beginnings and endings here, for sure. But again, don't think it's going to erase doubts. It doesn't erase doubts. Only the vision of oneness erases doubts. Put that, again, take that to the bank. Put it in the bank. It is for sure. Only the vision of oneness will erase your doubts. You'll say, for sure, light. Light is light. For sure, light is light. The everywhere presence of it is obvious. No doubts about it. Now we can go back to doubt. But it's not doubt about that. It's not doubt about the experience, actually. It's doubting about, well, can I, you know, keep that experience? Am I deserving of it? You know, how do I transfer that experience onto the external world? You cannot. You cannot do that. Cannot see two worlds at the same time. Meaning the awareness of the equal presence of light. You cannot at the same time have doubts think you're seeing unequal presence of light. You can't have both at the same time. So one has to be primary. If you see the light as light, you're not demanding from anything that it give you that experience, because the experience is already there everywhere. So you're not demanding of anything in particular. So you can still see everything. It's just that you're seeing the everywhere presence of light. Whatever you see, makes no impression change on the everywhere presence of light. This all may seem very esoteric, etc., but getting familiar with it, sitting quietly, getting familiar with it, and nothing beats sitting quietly to get familiar with anything, is really pay attention and just allow it, just getting used to it, getting used to it, getting used to it. Then you will find this easy. You'll say, oh, it's basic, it's simple stuff. What are you talking about? It's nothing esoteric. It's absolutely basic, cut and dried. It's completely obvious. Totally self-evident. It's all totally self-evident. Remember, we have spent a fortune in time and effort to avoid what is self-evident, to deny the self-evidency of truth. So all we're going back to is what is self-evident. We're not trying to do something fancy or tricky or difficult at all. It's completely self-evident truth. So we're just returning, a return to self-evidency. Return to self-evidency. The features, our demeanor in sitting quietly seems to be pretty poker-faced, naturally though, because a lot of the time we're not really forming thoughts or words, because we're simply in the mode of, let me just get used to this, you know, tremendous breakthrough, this new perspective. And so we're kind of in a wow state of mind, really. now state of mind. One has become hyperactive, the other has become very quiet. Hyperactivity is a desperate attempt to get back to the old state of mind. Because you say, where is it, where is it, where is it? I gotta find it, I gotta find it. See, we want to avoid that. You don't want to get back to the old state of sleeping. You want to wake up. So when you're waking up, you say, wow, this is really a different perspective. Just stay there. Just stay there. Don't get hyperactive. Don't go searching for the old perspective. Yeah, always is the same, which is good, because it's very familiar. Spiritual practice is very familiar, and that is you make these tremendous breakthroughs, and it's new territory, and you avoid hyperactivity, avoid trying to get back to where you came from. Forget it. Don't think about where you've been. They call it don't think about the past, but yeah, I don't look at it that way so much. You can say that, but you just don't look at the old perspective. You don't need that old perspective. The old perspective is not needed. So don't reactivate it. Don't reactivate. It's like you've clicked on another page, you've gone forward. Don't hit the, you know, click to the back button and go back. Just stay on the page you're on. You might be saying, I can't understand what's on this page. I can't read it very well. Wow, what is this? Stay on the page. Gradually, you'll get used to it. Click on any page, a page pops up, and what is this? What is this? It's different. Surfing on the internet actually is a helpful spiritual practice. It can be. I used to do a lot of that. Click, 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 thousands and thousands and thousands of different places, just, you know, just constant stream of different page, different page, everybody's like, wow, what's here? Okay, what's here? What's here? And you get used to having this poise of, I can go into unfamiliar territory like that. So there are ways to use technology in spiritual practice as part of a broader approach, actually. Whatever can work. But within your own mind, it's more powerful. Within, it's more powerful. The clarifications, breakthroughs that come is even way more powerful. But you can get used to saying, okay, I'm on a different page now. What's this? Huh? What's all these links here? What is this and that? And you just have to be patient with yourself, because you may not get it right away. Your intellect may not be able to grasp it, because this is like very different. If the intellect is easily grasping it, maybe you're not going deep enough, right? So you should challenge yourself. But not too much, because don't overcompensate where you feel like humiliated, like my intellect can't grasp this stuff. I'm going to jump really deep in, and maybe I'll get lucky and understand this, and I'll prove every intellect how great it is. And then people start taking drugs, having all these, you know, mystical drug experiences, trying to prove that they're really advanced or something, and that's not the way to go. That is not the way to go. That's a prideful reaction, overcompensation sort of thing. Be humble on the path and say, wow, I don't quite get this. Yeah, it's fine. Sit quietly, it's okay. I bet you tomorrow you're going to get it. It's amazing what a sleep on it, and the next day you say, oh, that's easy. But today it's tough. So always the day is tough, because you're getting into new territory. So you don't rest on your laurels at all, really. You cannot rest on your laurels here. So don't go back. Don't go back. If you can't understand the page you're on, don't go back. Stay on the page. Don't rush forward. Okay, there's another thing. What happens with drugs or some people, they get on a page, they don't understand. They get a breakthrough, they don't understand. And instead of admitting they don't understand or they don't get it, or you know, it's causing too much reverberation or a lot, instead of just sitting quietly and patiently, they feel humiliated with that. I don't want anyone to know that I'm having some trouble with this. So they'll leap to the next page, which they really don't understand even more. And they'll leap to the next, and the next, and the next, and the next. And before too long, they really have no clue. And then they really feel mortified. And then they start acting out in other ways. There's a lot of problems with drugs. A lot of young people get caught up in drugs because they have a hard time being humble. I know exactly what that's like. We all do. Because you're so smart when you're young, so quick, so smart. You say, I can get anything quickly, not a problem. And then when you can't get it, you don't want anyone to know that. So you jump to the next page, jump the next page, jump the next page. And then you feel like, wow, I'm really out of it. I'm really scared. What do I do now? People really think that I'm stupid. And then you start taking drugs. You say, you know what? I'm so smart, I can leap. I can leap quantum leaps, so no problem. Look at this. I'll take this drug and I have a very different experience. I got no problem with that. Of course, they feel very much disoriented and frightened. They don't want anyone to know that, so they take the drugs again and say, that's no problem. I got no problem. Look, I'll take it again. And I'll take it again. I'll show you. Really, the drug problem has a lot to do with young people not being brought up with humility. It's okay to be humble. And parents, of course, most parents are like saying, you got to be quick. You got the answer. I mean, a lot of these, you know, people, parents like in Silicon Valley, for instance, they press their children so much. He says, you got to be perfect, meaning you can't take any time to make a decision. You got to just look at it and you know the answer right like that. Come on. Because that's how they got to be in management positions and powerful positions, lucrative positions, is making it real quick. You know, I get it real quick. So when you try to go in depth, you don't get it. And you say, whoa, I can't let my parents know that. I can't let anybody know that. And it snowballs and snowballs and snowballs on you. And before you know it, you're into drugs. And before you know it, you're really hooked on drugs. And before you know it, you're going on to other drugs, harder drugs. It's exactly what happens. Now, if you're a parent and you're on the spiritual path, you have to show humility to the children, for sure. You have to raise them with humility. It's okay, sit quietly, I don't get it. What are you doing? Well, they ask, what are you doing? Well, I just had a real big breakthrough, and I'm just like, wow, I just need to sit quietly here and get used to this, because this is really new territory to me, and it's really mind-blower, so I need to really just, I don't know how to respond or what to say or anything. I'm just going to sit here quietly and manage this. And the kids will look at it and say, wow, okay. So it's okay to sit quietly and feel overwhelmed temporarily. Okay, it's the parents that say, who are you to be overwhelmed? Are you my child? I mean, I'm not overwhelmed by anything. Come on, shake it off. You can do it, you know. That's where the problems for sure arise. The anxiety arises from this. Stress, drug problems, you want to cure all that stuff in young people. Let the parents be humble. Let society be humble. Let the neighborhood, the culture, the school, all take a path of humility. And you would wipe out all that stuff for the great majority of it. It would ease off so much. It would be absolutely miraculous. Just the parent to say, I don't know. What's the answer? I don't know. I'm just sitting in this. I don't know this. It's okay to be. I don't know this. Quiet mind. you know, just before dinner, his parents just say, okay, everyone, what have you had today, which was new territory, new unfamiliar territory that really was so amazing, you know, so let's just all assume that we have had some of that today, and let us sit quietly here. Wordlessly, quietly. And recognize our humility that we have such a severe continuity problem, we have to be very humble here. Because we're going to get, and to take that path, you have to have humility. So let us spend some time in humility here. Just some quiet time, no talking, no thinking, just allowance and honoring your great progress. Let's honor our great progress by this silence today. This would change the world to a large extent, a significant extent. Of course, it would help everyone with the continuity problem. It would help society. And when society's helped, everyone is helped. This is the modern scourge. And I say we're going into the belly of beast because the world lacks humility. And that definitely puts you in the belly of the beast. The ultimate humility is used to accept that I don't have any beginning. Then, you know, you've got the supreme peace, the absolute stillness. I am absolute stillness. If you want to say I am absolute stillness. The absolute stillness of no beginning and no ending. I am the absolute stillness of no beginning and no ending. And I don't know what that means. There's no I knowing that there's no beginning or no ending. How can there be an I knowing this? That would be a beginning of knowing that there's no beginning or ending. It's everywhere knowledge. I can't know anything. I don't know is another great way to help. I don't know. Let's everyone say, I don't know. I don't know. I can't know anything. I can't know anything. I can't know. I don't know. I can't know anything. Because there's only universal knowledge. All is universal knowledge. All is universal being. All is universal knowledge. There's no beginning or ending anywhere for anything. Everything is always available right now, equally so. So all is universal knowledge. I can't know that that there is no beginning or ending. Because again, only everything can know that. You can't say that I know it, as opposed to something else not knowing it. It's just all knowing it. And all knowing it, there's no beginning or no end really to the knowing, is there? So, humility, humility, humility. I don't know anything. I can't know anything. I can't know anything. If everything knows everything, what meaning does it have to say, well, I know something? There's no meaning to it, actually. So you can say the words, but it doesn't have any relevance. There's no relevance. Don't need to say that. It's not needed. False flags are coming, and how to help with that? That's the pressure. So much pressure right now, too. Everyone will want to react. It will throw everyone into a reactive condition. So I'm trying to prepare for that. I've been given a heads up. Now, sometimes false flags are pushed back, you know, because maybe the preparedness of the world shifts, and they say, "Wow, this won't work. That won't work right at this time. We need to do some other stuff too." They're trying to get reactivity in the world, so they may have to, keep shifting. It's like a chess match, kind of a chess match, but. Now, some false flag happens. Ask yourself, is the space where this happened, is the space bothered by this? Is the space disturbed by this? Is the space saying, I wish that hadn't happened in my space? Is the space saying, I'm so upset? Did the space get upset by happenings in space? Is space pro-something? Is it demanding? Is it personality? Space a personality? Spaciousness, pure spaciousness, is that a personality? I hurt my back yesterday. This lady had an electric cart, big, huge lady, electric cart. She bumped a display of bread. It was on a stand. And a basket on the wicker basket on a metal stand. The stand fell over and the bread fell on the floor. She's shrieking and, oh my God. And I rushed over and said, what's wrong? I thought she's hurt herself or something. And then I saw the bread on the floor and I was like, oh wow, I gotta help her out. So I picked up the bread and tried to pick up the wicker basket. Everything was all falling and it was just like, I ended up hurting my back. It's stupid. So it's better to stay calm and assess. This is showing me something about what's to come, actually, and how to react to it. I didn't react the right way, for sure. Especially when there's some handicapped person involved, you want to help them like immediately and be the. And she was praising me. Oh, what a great man! What a wonderful man you are! This is what an angel, you know. Angel in need came rushing to my aid. Thank you so much. You know, she's really, praising me. So, and then I hurt myself. My back's, it's hurting. This has to do, I believe, with the false flag. so my approach was incorrect. Right approach is to look, are you okay? You're okay. Okay, so you're okay. There's no emergency here, all right? But I wanted to calm her down. You know, I guess I wanted to be the hero or something. Let me calm her down fast. Well, maybe you can't calm her down fast. Let her shriek. You know, she was shrieking over nothing. A couple of loaves of bread on the ground. Come on. But I assume there's something really bad had happened because, you know, her reactions are so volatile and emotional. So we need to look at some things. Is space been harmed by anything that happens in space? Is space harmed by anything that happens in space? Is space changed by anything that happens in space? So if that's the case, we've not lost space. We haven't changed. Space is fine. If space is fine, you know, reality hasn't been changed, has it? We assume that this is like cosmically changed the cosmos. Something terrible, terrible catastrophe is irreversibly changed. What? Changed space? Has space been changed? You know, if you have a bottle and you open the lid and you pour out the water. Is space somehow damaged? Is space damaged? I don't mean the atmosphere. Of course we can pollute the atmosphere, but has the actual spaciousness been damaged? Has spaciousness been damaged in any way? Has it been changed, compromised, corrupted, shrunk? Has it been shrunken up? Shattered? If there's a huge explosion, has space been shattered? Has spaciousness been shattered? Just something to consider here. So, first thing you say, okay, is the person, people okay? People are okay, all right, great. Second, it's a bit of a mess here. All right, let's take a look at the mess. What caused it? What's the problem here? Now, people will be frantic because they can't figure out what caused it, and that'll cause the reactions to go. You know, I figured out finally it's the stand that it's on is imbalanced, and it's top heavy. So I actually rearranged the loaves of bread so going back towards the wall so it's not so tipping forward. It was set up to tip. The whole thing was a setup. I mean, she barely bumped it; the whole thing came over. So it definitely was set up that way. Just the slightest touch is going to, the whole thing's going to come down. It's a setup. So you realize, and then people realize, wow, it's a conspiracy. It's a setup. Yeah. What caused it? And you can, you know, kind of figure that out. I figured out, you know, what caused it. And then you fix it, and you don't panic. You don't get upset. But the question remains, what is the response? Where does the focus need to be on any disaster like that? Very important to know this. First, you can say it's the light pretending to not be the light. And then you need to be aware that the light, the vision of oneness, if you realize the light is the light. And so there's no concern, no worry at all, actually. But we'll certainly be faced with this. We were faced with this in 9/11, and we have flunked the test. Flunked the test. We better learn from that one, for sure. Me, I flunked it because I went running to, you know, Big Mother. He ran to Mommy for reassurance. Mommy can't really reassure you, so she wants you to do all this stuff for her to reassure her. And then she'll say, once you reassure me, I'll reassure you. It's like a pyramid scam. Flunk the test. Flunk the test. Don't want to flunk this next test. This earth, all of this form, is really being used to try and give us the appearance that space is being changed, that spaciousness is being changed. This is a great way to look at it. It has no meaning of its own. It really does not. But by putting our focus on form, we can draw the conclusion like, whoa, something really happened. Oh, we mean something happened to space. So did something really happen to space? Is the question. Did something really happen to space? Is the question. If it didn't happen to space, then what are we concerned about? Because we are spaciousness. We are, that is the ground of our being, as it were. We are the omnipresence. So did some happening, some appearance change that in some way? Now, it's easy to say this, so we're just looking at it. So sitting here patiently waiting for the answer. The answer hasn't come yet. We're asking the right question, actually. Because we're going to be faced with that very, very soon. I don't know how to change space. So we might start with saying, well, I still don't know how to change space. This example here is useless. Didn't change space. I don't know how to change space. There is no such knowledge. So this is useless as far as knowledge goes. It doesn't help. Is useless. All form in terms of knowledge is useless. No knowledge to get from form at all. So, right now, this is humbling because I can't get the answer. So I go back to young people and the feeling, the pressure they're under, the natural want to show their parents how smart they are. And the parents think, aha, I got great leverage to make Junior, Mrs., with the, you know, make the children really smart. Because I can act like, it's like, oh, that's not that much, you know. You should have got it faster than that. In other words, I can make them compete against themselves as far as getting stuff real quick. I can raise up a super children who are going to be very successful and wealthy, and I'll have a nice retirement. When I get older, they'll be able to take care of me. So the tendency is towards that. I want really successful kids. Of course, what happens if they push that too far is kids get depressed, they get anxiety, they can't sleep, they get depression. So suicidal, actually. Unfortunately, absolutely, that does happen. We had a good friend of the family, young person, just a little bit younger than me, commit suicide. Committed to a mental institution, committed suicide. I couldn't help him. He came for me to help, I couldn't help him. That was terrible. But, you know, it wasn't my fault. Anyway, a lot of doctors trying to help. I tried to give him some perspective, but he was under too much pressure to get things quick. No humility there. He had no humility. This happens to a lot. They're So you have to be humble. I don't have the answer right this moment. How do we, you know, you hear the kids, how do I solve the world's problems, you know? Their parents expect them to solve the world's problems. Hey, you're here. This is what you're here for. We want you to, you know, cure the environment. We want you to cure all this. We want you to cure this and this and this and this. It puts this like insane burden on the children. And of course, being young, they want to prove their parents how smart they are. They want to, like, I'm not an infant, I don't need you anymore, I'm smart. And so they'll keep leaping further, quicker and quicker, you know, keep leaping forward, thinking that they know, they've got it. Or they're not, they're bluffing. They don't get it. They don't know. They just think, I'll just keep going and taking more and more classes, and eventually I will know. Meanwhile, I'll just keep bluffing and then they get caught up in this, you know, bluff. And they get afraid that somebody will know and will realize they don't know. That's unacceptable. You can't say, I don't know how to solve the world's problems. You know, who can say that? Again, the only problem we have is the continuity problem. So you're not being called to solve the world's problems. Along the way to solving the continuity problem, which is the vision of oneness, as you move towards that, the world's problems will actually soften up automatically if the world does that. The more the world tries to solve its problems, the worse it gets. The problems may change form. Formatting may change. You may think you've solved something, you know, a lot, but for instance, you solve a lot of diseases, and then you got like extreme overpopulation, which puts extreme burden on the ecosystem, so you end up with an even worse problem than you started out with. It's like you go to a tribe of people in a ecosystem where they're balanced with what's available, and they have this delicate balance of food and resource availability, and you say, hey, I noticed you're like dying at, you know, 55, or, you know, some of your children don't live and all this stuff. I'm bringing all this medicine for you. I'm going to set up a hospital here and everything, and you're all going to live to be 90 years old. You know, you have great big families. Everything will be great. And they say, oh, wow, that's wonderful. So now the tribe, you know, triples, quadruples, you know, very fast. And what happens? Can't get enough food. What do? Then they start burning down the rainforest so they can plant a bunch of quick crops. Then they get into the green revolution. Let's put commercial fertilizer on. The fertilizers get into the ecosystem, the rivers. They start poisoning the fish. They have less fish. The whole thing falls apart, all because some do-gooder said, hey, let's come in here and do some good. Let's give these medicines to these people. So unintended consequences, but even a more, you know, anyone could see that coming. Who's to say that those people who came in with all those medicines to help, their real objective was to, again, is the play of changing space. They said, let's destroy this rainforest and see if that changes space. How do we destroy the rainforest? Make sure all these native people have long lives and their children are all healthy and everything. And that causes a chain reaction to destroying the rainforest, actually. And who's to say they hadn't thought of that ahead of time, right? I say, let's see if we can really change space. This may be a space changer right here. Right. We say that all these things are unintended consequences. How do we know there's unintended? Could be that everything that's happening is absolutely intended. And more to come. More to come. And people say, oh, well, we didn't intend that. Wow. No, yes, they did. Yes, they did. You can't trust anything that's taking place in the world thinking you know what's going on. No. Really, not really. The events that happen, that's why the history is fascinating. People are fascinated with history because they really study it. They say, wow, the way the history is written is not true. This was unintended. This was, say, no. Look at this happen and this happened. Now, ultimately, you know, the conspiracy people say, hey, there's conspiracies everywhere. Well, that is true. In fact, it's all a conspiracy. It's all intentional. It's a conspiracy to change spaciousness. Conspiracy to change spaciousness. Change reality. Change the nature of reality. It's all intentional. But we make it appear to not be intentional. It's all a false flag. Existence is a false flag. It really is. It's just one big false flag conspiracy, all of existence. You'll have to like divide it up into little pieces. See, there's so many conspiracy people that go crazy. They keep trying to pin down, you know, like this conspiracy or that. Just look at it as one big conspiracy. Why don't keep trying to pay attention to all the trees and label the trees, study the trees. This is just one big forest here. It's one forest of conspiracy, of intentionality. It's all intentional. Everything's intentional. Everything, including the stuff that we insist are sacred cows and can't be intentional. That's intentional too. Disasters, catastrophes, horrific events, public, large scale, personal scale, whatever scale, it's all intentional. It's all saying this definitely confuses space. Does space get confused? Does space get confused? You do a false flag of space confused? The whole world's confused, like, what caused this? 9/11, what happened? What really happened there? Is space confused? What does space need to be confused about? What is space? What does space need to be confused about? Does space have needs? Does space have needs? Does space have clarity? Even, does space even have clarity? Does it need to have clarity? Does that mean it could be confused? Oh, this is a very clear space here. I mean, a very clear space. Is the space clear? Or is it unclear? Can it be unclear or clear? Can it be confused? Or is it like pure clarity? Pure clarity can't be not clear. Purely clear. So it can't be clear. So the words, oh, this is clear space. Does that have meaning for clear space? Or pure, this is pure clear space. Does that have meaning? But it can't be anything other than that. So what meaning does it have to to delineate it compared to what? You can't compare it to itself. Reality cannot be compared to itself. Reality cannot be compared to itself. So, has the space suffered a catastrophe? Is the space confused? Is the space suffering? Is the space hurting? We assume that it is, but is that what we intend? Aren't we saying to space, hey space, look at my death, I'm dying. You're dying too, space. Aren't we trying to get space to infer that? It too is dying. I'm dying, so space is dying. What if we found out that nothing is happening to space at all? Would we really keep on dying? Do I need to keep dying then? Or I need to keep suffering? Keep having problems? Do we need to do that? It's useless, right? Space is immaculate. The immaculate virgin refers to the spaciousness. It's a way of referring to spaciousness, a symbol. Immaculate virgin is completely virginal. Nothing ever touches it. Nothing ever changes what it is in the slightest bit. Completely immaculate. Without even trying. There's no one in charge of an effort. There's no one advising space, you need to do this. We think that space is the way it is because the eye is telling it, space, you need to be this way, you need to be this way. So the eye is like playing, we're playing God and saying, we're the ones who are telling space, and space is making the effort, makes the effort to be like we ask it to be. But is that true? Is that true? Is space needs to be told to be space? By space. You gotta keep acting like space. Don't go off track, don't go off cue. Off script, don't go off script, space. Come on. Can space go off script? I haven't eaten really a meal in 29 hours, I guess, 29 hours. So I'm starting to feel a little tired and hungry, but this is too important. We have efforts to convince us that time and space can be changed coming up. Now it seems like a very lack of compassion to just say, well, your suffering is not changing time and space. Doesn't it? Seems very much that way. They say, well, yes, it is. It's terrible. You got to help me out. Otherwise, space is going to be harmed, hurt by my suffering. Now, I think the real teachers would be to remain in absolute stillness. Absolute stillness. Now, once people see that they cannot get the teacher to react in any way, you know what? Suffering goes away, illness goes away. They say, wow, that didn't work. That didn't work. So if you really want a healing, don't react to anything that happens. Want to heal the world, don't react to anything that takes place here. Sri Anandamayi Ma was like that. Certainly helped out a great deal. didn't react to anything that was taking place here. Remained in absolute certitude, absolute stillness. No beginning, no ending. Didn't react to anything that happened, really. Of course, what we are is pure spaciousness. Spirit may be like a puff of a breeze within pure spaciousness, but pure space, the reality is pure spaciousness, the pure spaciousness, the everywhereness, the omnipresence, and the light is omnipresent, the pure spaciousness, the light, and so it can't be changed, and we're trying to change it. So to simply not react is to say, you're not changing it, don't worry, you're not changing it. If someone's reacting like, then they think, oh wow, my God, I am changing it, then they get even more frightful. If people die and it's an event, be absolutely still, continue in your absolute stillness. Those who died will get the feeling like, oh, that didn't work. I'm not going to try that again. Those who live, they see, oh, that didn't work. I'm not going to try that myself. Getting tired. So maybe I'll take a break and get something to eat and come back strong. This we're really pressing this. We're really onto this here. If you look at the world and you see it's just an attempt to change space by convincing ourselves that space can be changed, like as if we take a vote and say, yeah, I think that one changed space. Everybody agree? Okay, it must have changed it then. If you simply don't react to anything that takes place, then people maybe say, hey, maybe I don't need to have this body. I mean, getting a body that's vulnerable is a way of saying, hey, look space, look how hurt this body is, look at the trouble this body has. You are now, you're part of this troubled body space. You're in trouble too. Is that true? Is that true? Is that true? What's the nature of pure spaciousness? What is that nature? If we see that, maybe we say, hey, I don't need to keep on playing this foolish game with bodies. Trying to convince myself that, trying to convince pure spaciousness that it's under attack. That's under attack. Is really, how do you attack pure spaciousness? You write on a building or you write something, pure spaciousness, and then they send something there, and boom! Oh, look, pure spaciousness. Look what happened to it. Pretty much all we can do. So we define lives as if they were pure spaciousness itself, and then the lives are lost. We say, look what happened. Look, life. Life is gone. Life has been lost. Pure spaciousness has been lost. So we can set up some situation where we simply don't react to what takes place. No reaction that takes place. People call praying for peace. Is that you don't react to war. Wait, you want peace? Don't react to war. Refuse to give it any importance. okay, I'm really starting to sink here. So I'm gonna get something to eat. All right, very great. That's it, and we'll see if we can keep pushing this July 4th thing through. All right, that's it.